white horses on New Year's Eve, walking down my Brooklyn street. And I saw fireworks in your eyes. I was falling, falling, falling 1 year ago at this time. Now I'm trying, trying, trying to get back my mind. I'll take my photographs, wrap them in bubble wrap. I'm leaving for the weekend, or maybe for the year. I'll secure all my edges, all the fragile remarks that were taken the wrong way.
Hey, how's it going? Welcome. My name's John. Welcome to John's Bus Conversion, episode 1862, or something like that. This week, the video is for Annie, also known as Aliana. She was 11 years old when I started this series. She's 15 now. Amazing how time flies. Anyway, she is interested in how everything in the bus works and how everything is put together and all that. And so she even threatened to watch some of the old videos. I thought, wow, that's a fate worse than death. Why don't I just make a video showing how everything works? Because other people might be interested in that as well. So that's what we're going to be looking at this time. Some of you probably already watched this channel, probably already know about Justin Credible's channel. If you don't, check it out. But my favorite saying from Justin is, he'll say, this is not a how-to video, this is a how-I-did-it video. And that is exactly what this is. This is how I did it. Not necessarily the best way or the only way. Well, certainly not the only way. But this is how I did it. So I'm going to show you how I put my bus together and how all the moving parts work. So I hope you'll find it interesting. Stay tuned. I'm going to be talking about the electrical system in this video. And then next week, I will discuss the plumbing for the wastewater, freshwater, and propane systems. So every RV is typically going to have two sets of batteries. So in here, these batteries here are the ones that are used to start the engine, the headlights, the ignition. It's called the SLI, starter lights, ignition batteries. These, I think every diesel typically has two, but whatever. This one has two batteries, and they're wired in parallel, which means that the positives are connected together and the negatives are connected together. And so you still end up, these are two 12-volt batteries, you still end up with 12 volts, but it's twice the cranking power capacity. Over here is this battery bank that I made by dropping this thing down and putting hinges on it. And let's take a look in there. So I made this battery tray in here. And this will hold, this will hold six of these. I've got two of them in there now. These are 6-volt golf cart batteries. And these are wired in series, which means the negative of the first battery goes to the positive of the second battery. And when you do it that way, you double the voltage. So these are 2 6-volt batteries wired in series, which makes 12 volts. This is what's used to power the lights, the fans, the inverter, everything in the living part of the bus. This device here is called an isolator. And what the isolator's purpose is to allow both battery banks to be charged when the engine is running. But when I'm running off the house batteries, in the, which are the 2 6-volt ones, it will only draw off those. And so I could run those down if I was, you know, parked out somewhere, and it wouldn't run down the battery to start the vehicle. So that's what the isolator does. And you generally want to have that, or a switch or a relay or some sort of thing like that. Now, as far as charging the batteries, as I mentioned, just running the engine will charge the batteries. And so running the engine when I'm driving, I'm charging both banks of batteries. And there are a couple other ways I can charge the batteries as well. Now, this bus has solar panels on the top. I've got 4 100-watt solar panels on the roof, making 400 watts. The solar panels are wired in parallel, and the wire comes down through here, through this conduit over here to the solar controller here. And the purpose of the solar controller is to, it's basically a regulator that allows the battery to be charged when it needs to be charged, but prevents it from being overcharged, which would fry the battery. And then over here, this device is a pretty useful device to have. It's the battery monitor. So you can see the battery's at 14 volts right now. You can see there are 2 amps going into the battery, and the battery's 99% full, according to this thing. And I can also see the number of amp hours. So it's got 1.5 amp hours has been drawn off the battery. So this is a handy device to have as a battery monitor, so you can see what the condition of the battery is and prevent it from getting fried. Another way I can charge the battery is my smart battery charger down here. And that comes into effect when the bus is plugged in to a regular, like an RV electrical outlet, which is called shore power. When it is, I can flip this switch on here, and that will turn the battery charger on, and I can charge the battery that way as well. But the bus has AC power as well, which is, if you're in North America, I think all parts of North America use 110 volts AC, and it's accessed via these outlets here. There are a couple of ways that that can happen. This is my 30 amp inlet that I can plug into a regular RV electrical hookup, and that's 110 volts AC, 30 amp. These also come in 50 amp, and if I had it to do over again, I would probably do a 50 amp, but mine's 30 amp. So if I plug this in, all the AC outlets in the bus are energized. The shore power inlet we just saw comes through here, and over behind the plumbing here is an auto transfer switch right back here. The inlet to the shore power goes into the auto transfer switch, as well as from the inverter, which we're about to see. And that will automatically transfer between either shore power or the inverter. If I had the inverter running and I plugged in the shore power, there's a delay, I think it's 30 seconds or something like that. But then the auto transfer switch would automatically switch to shore power. So you won't have both of them running at the same time, which could cause issues. So from there, it goes to the distribution panel, which we'll take a look at in a minute. If the bus is not hooked up to shore power, I can also generate AC electrical using this 2000 watt Samlex inverter. This is a pure sine wave inverter, and so it costs a little bit more than a square wave inverter. Some devices don't care, and others do. So you may or may not need a sine wave, pure sine wave inverter, but I do, because I have a laser printer and some other stuff that wants it. I can turn the Samlex on with this remote up here. And so now it's running, and all the outlets are now energized. If we want to see how much the Samlex runs, we can turn the solar off here. And then look at the number of amps that are being drawn. So you can see the Samlex with no load on it is already using almost 2 amps. So you want to avoid using AC if you can, because it's not as efficient as just running straight off the battery. And in fact, here we're running almost 2 amps without doing anything at all except running the inverter. And here's my distribution panel. This is specifically for a dual system like this, either an off-grid or an RV or something like that. My 110 AC circuits come through here, and each one of them has a circuit breaker. You always want to use a circuit breaker or a fuse for every circuit, because otherwise if there's a short or something, it could overload and cause a fire. Instead, the circuit or breaker will pop or the fuse will blow. Down here are my 12 volt. You can see I haven't used all of them. I have room for expansion. But each 12 volt circuit has its own fuse as well. And so this distribution panel distributes both AC and DC power. Okay, well, I hope you all found that interesting. Next week I will do the plumbing, wastewater, composting toilet, propane, all that good stuff. So thanks for watching. See you next time.